Hi, I'm Kathy Johnson. I'm the director of the United States Diplomacy Center at the Department of State. Thank you for joining us today. I'm a career foreign service officer in the Senior Foreign Service and the daughter of a career senior foreign service officer. I've been in the service almost 30 years. I'm a management career track officer, but I've done both management and policy positions. I've had a number of overseas tours in Europe, Latin America, the Middle East, and the East Asia Pacific region, as well as tours in Washington, D.C. My present tour is probably my favorite job. I'm the director of the United States Diplomacy Center, which is going to be the first museum in the United States dedicated to diplomacy. It's a really exciting project. It will be both a museum and an education center, where visitors from around the world, student groups, can come to Washington, D.C. to learn more about diplomacy, to interact with American diplomats, to look at our exhibits and artifacts. We have over 6,000 artifacts in our collection so far that will tell the story of American diplomacy, who diplomats are, what they do, the issues that they work on. One exhibit has already been debuted. It's in a preview right now at the Ronald Reagan Building here in Washington, D.C. It's called Faces of Diplomacy. And on the screen, you should be able to see some of the photos of some of the diplomats and those who work in support of American diplomacy. The exhibit is really exciting because it gives a glimpse into who are our diplomats, where do they come from, what kind of work do they do, where do they do that work, and why did they choose to become a diplomat. This exhibit is sponsored by the U.S. Department of State through the United States Diplomacy Center with a very generous grant from the Annenberg Foundation, funded by Wallis Annenberg and the Annenberg Foundation through our private sector partner, the Diplomacy Center Foundation. We partnered with the Corcoran School of Art to produce the beautiful portraits of our diplomats and those who work in support of diplomacy, and videos on why they do the work they do, with a wonderful montage of photos from their careers. It highlights the real diversity and the talent in our workforce and those who serve around the world in pursuit of U.S. national interests. Our diplomats come from diverse backgrounds, different places, different educational backgrounds, and it's really exciting to me to be able to have several of them on our Google Hangout today. We've brought together practitioners who work for both the Department of State and for the U.S. Agency for International Development, foreign service officers, and civil service officers. And I'm having a little paper issue here. Thank you, folks. Okay, let me introduce the panel who will be part of our Google Hangout today. First of all, I have Carla Capel, who is the Chief Strategy Officer for the United States Agency for International Development. And Carla is patching in here from Washington, D.C. I have Michelle Los Baños, our diplomat in residence in Southern California, who is a foreign service officer with the United States Department of State. Michelle's patching in from Los Angeles. Mary Bliss, who's the Deputy Director of the Office for Central American and Mexican Affairs with USAID, and one of our features in the Faces of Diplomacy exhibit. Mary's joining us and patching in from Peru. And Andy Ravens, Special Advisor for Global Youth Issues with the Office of the Undersecretary for Public Diplomacy and Public Affairs, also with the U.S. Department of State. Andy's another one of those featured in our Faces of Diplomacy exhibit. Our program today will proceed as follows. I'll start with a few questions for our panel, and then we'll take questions from those of you who are watching. You're invited to post your questions live on the U.S. Diplomacy Center's Twitter page at Diplomacy Center. So I'd like to ask our panelists, can you tell us what moment you felt inspired to become involved in diplomacy, and how did you act on that interest? And Carla, may I start with you?
Sure. First of all, thank you so much for having me, and congratulations on putting together such a rich program for the Diplomacy Center as we put all of the pieces together for a launch. I always wanted to work in international affairs, and what I didn't realize was how that could manifest itself in so many different ways. And in fact, started out my career working with the United Nations, and then moved back to the United States to work in the United States on international affairs. And when I arrived back in Washington, D.C., found the enormous pride I could have in representing the United States people and the U.S. government through working with U.S. Agency for International Development, which of course is the lead branch of the U.S. federal government dedicated to promoting development and providing development assistance to countries around the world. Our mission is to end extreme poverty and to promote resilient democratic societies, which, as we all know, as part of U.S. foreign policy, is a goal which brings peace and prosperity globally to the U.S. and to others around the world.
That's great. Michelle, how about you?
Hi, thanks for having me today. It's a pleasure to be here. So, 17 years ago, I was an undergraduate student in Washington, D.C., and I came to our nation's capital with the purpose of figuring out how I could have a career in public service. I'm originally from the San Francisco Bay Area, but I went to undergrad in D.C., and while I was there, I went to a career fair to try to figure out what I would do with the rest of my life, and there was a diplomat in residence there at a table manning a booth, just like what I do out here now in Southern California, and he introduced me to the idea of serving in the U.S. Foreign Service through a fellowship that back then was called the Foreign Affairs Fellowship. But today, it's called the Thomas Pickering Fellowship in honor of a very dedicated ambassador of ours, Thomas Pickering. And so I looked into it and looked into the career and thought, wow, this is an exciting way to serve my country and get a chance to see the world and travel abroad and encounter different cultures. And so I went for it, I applied for it, and sure enough, I got the fellowship, and I've been on a track in the Foreign Service ever since, and I've now been a Foreign Service officer for the past 12 and a half years, and my career has taken me to Turkey and Nicaragua, Italy, Suriname, and now here to the sunny shores of California in Los Angeles.
That's great, Michelle. I also served as a diplomat in residence for one of my tours, and it's a fabulous job. Having the opportunity to speak to university or students around the country about who we are and what we do, and I might also say that we're very honored that Ambassador Pickering, who has been a role model to many of us and is just a stellar diplomat, is one of the directors of our private sector partner who is helping us create the United States Diplomacy Center, the Diplomacy Center Foundation. So Ambassador Pickering and his work has touched many of our lives. So we're very grateful to him as a mentor and a leader. Andy, what interested you? How did you join our ranks?
Sure. Well, thank you, Kathy. It's great to be on a panel with four dynamic women from the State Department. That's always a good thing. And thank you, everyone, for tuning in and taking the time to be with us for this hour. My path to the State Department, my freshman year in college, I had aspirations to be a professional tennis player and thought that sports was the direction that I was going in. And I got to campus out in Cambridge. A few days later, after initial tennis practices, 9/11 happens. And a couple friends, I grew up in the Bay Area like Michelle, 9/11 happens, and a number of friends who had come out from New York talked about the family members and friends who had been greatly affected from the attacks in New York. And to me personally, it raised a lot of questions about cross-cultural communications, about the greater world that we live in. It connected to a sense of ignorance that I felt that I had about the larger world that we were a part of, and led me to question a lot of things about our current cross-cultural efforts and opportunities to really understand the diversity that was on the campus at Harvard, but more importantly, about young people and the connectivity that was potentially there going forward. So I ended up enrolling in a couple of international relations classes, got hooked by politics and international relations and people-to-people diplomacy and opportunities. I ended up interning at an embassy overseas for the State Department one summer in college. And then after graduating, had tried to find a way to be a part of public service and international affairs. It took a little while. I ended up going to Capitol Hill. I went to graduate school for a year in London, and then eventually found a way into the State Department through a Presidential Management Fellowship Program. That's a two-year civil service opportunity to come into the department. And I've been at the State Department for about 6.5 years, ever since 2008. And it's been a phenomenal experience. Has been a chance to actually live and to try to practice the challenging task of trying to connect people across different cultures and backgrounds together. And it's incredibly fulfilling work, and you get to meet some amazing people like some of the folks who are on the panel today. So I would strongly encourage anyone thinking about careers in the Foreign Service or the Civil Service or USAID or international development as a whole to really take that seriously.
And Andy, where did you serve your internship?
It was at the embassy in London. So it was my first time living overseas, and the diversity of people in London further whet that appetite for trying to understand the larger world that we live in.
Thank you. Mary, I'm so glad you could join us from Peru. In addition to telling us what inspired you to join our ranks, could you just digress for a second and tell us what you're doing in Peru?
Absolutely. I'm here working at the USAID mission. We're working on preparing for a exciting conference on science, technology, innovation, and partnerships. So just helping out for a few weeks on that initiative.
Great. So what inspired you to join USAID?
Well, I probably first realized I wanted to work internationally during my junior year abroad, living in Spain. After graduating from Bucknell, I received a TESOL certificate, Teach English as a Second Official Language, in London, and I joined the Berlitz staff in Singapore teaching English. And from there, I moved to Shanghai to study Mandarin before beginning my master's program at Middlebury Institute of International Studies in Monterey, California. And in 2004, during that time, I obtained an internship with my soon-to-become mentor, a woman named Loriana Dambele, who is the Italian consulate to Mali, as well as the president of a local Malian nonprofit. So as both the longest-serving foreign diplomat in Mali and the director of a nonprofit, I was very eager to learn from her, and inspired by her work, I established a nonprofit organization in 2004 named Practical Small Projects, and I returned to Mali as a Fulbright scholar, great State Department program. And through my nonprofit, we would construct potable water systems, healthcare centers, schools, and provided solar energy installations. And at that time, I also co-founded a for-profit solar enterprise run by locals in Mali. So I would say that my work with the nonprofit and the for-profit in Mali gave me a chance in a small way to represent my country to Malians in the nature of diplomacy. And after working on the ground in rural villages for several years in a more grassroots level, and presenting my work to organizations such as the World Bank and other international conferences, I was very much inspired to apply to USAID, and that's really what led me there. And I've been with USAID since 2009 and worked in Nicaragua and Haiti and now in Central America, South America affairs. And Couldn't be happier.
Thank you. It's really interesting because my father, who is a retired diplomat, has a very similar story where he was working as a scientist and was at a conference and someone came along and said, we think you'd be great to do a Fulbright. He went off as a Fulbright scholar to Finland for a year and then later joined the Department of State and served a long and distinguished career on scientific cooperation and nuclear issues. But these, as our panelists have illustrated here, people come to service with the Department of State, with USAID, from a variety of avenues, and it's fascinating to me to listen to everyone's stories. Let me go back to Michelle, if I may. Michelle, you work in the international affairs arena. Can you give an example from your career of how your work has touched the lives of American people? Is there a story that you could share with our listeners?
Yeah, absolutely. So in the Foreign Service, of course, when you join, you have to choose one of five different career tracks, or as we call them, cones. And my cone is the public diplomacy cone. I've had an incredible career serving in that specialty, and one of the best things about it is that I'm charged with facilitating interactions between Americans and citizens around the world through a variety of different programs. So as an example, the State Department supports the exchange of Americans in the arts. And so one of the programs that I worked on a couple of years ago is our American Music Abroad program. And that's where we send American musicians overseas to countries around the world to share a little bit about American culture, but also just to interact with citizens around the world and talk to them, give master classes in music, give workshops to kids, and also learn from local musicians and local cultures that they visit. So a couple of years ago, we sent an all-female bluegrass band to Pakistan. And they toured around the country. They sang at different orphanages. They went to different women's colleges around the country. And they came back, these American women, who are also Grammy-nominated for Best Bluegrass Album of the Year that year. Cool. They came back and they said that the experience for them was very transformative, and it influenced their music as well. And while they were in Pakistan, they learned the folk song of a Pakistani national poet. And any time after their trip overseas, when they were back in the U.S. touring around the bluegrass scene and circuit, they would play the folk song, the Pakistani folk song that they learned while they were there. And it was a chance for them to share a little bit about the culture that touched them and influenced them while they were on their trip abroad. And they tried to do that by bringing a little bit of that back home to the U.S. so that they could share their experience with other Americans around the country. So that's just an example and the tip of the iceberg of many of ways that we help bring Americans together with citizens around the world and vice versa.
That's a great example. I've had the pleasure of participating and watching and listening to some of those music programs, and they're really an excellent venue for cultural exchanges. Carla, how about you? Is there a story that you'd like to share from your career?
Sure, absolutely. Well, first of all, obviously when I reflect generally on how U.S. development assistance and USAID touches the lives of Americans, I immediately think of the trade benefits that we get from investing in countries that then become vibrant markets for U.S. goods and services. But on a more personal level, what I would say is that it's been very interesting for me to look at how, for example, we work around the world, and I was working on a project in the Dominican Republic that was trying to figure out how to enable loans to very low-income populations. And these are families and communities that don't have a credit history, don't have credit cards, don't have necessarily secure title to land or their homes. And we figured out how to track their purchases and their payments so that they could get loans to grow their businesses and to enable them to pay their school fees. And what I saw was quite amazing because it then in the fast forward, I was able to take the approaches that we had used in the Dominican Republic back to the United States to work with communities of low-income people in the United States who also hadn't had credit cards and hadn't gotten loans before. Folks living along the border, the southern border states, some of the folks in Appalachia, Native American reservation inhabitants. And through foreign assistance, we were learning strategies for reaching folks here in the United States who otherwise wouldn't have had that access to resources to enable them to better their families and communities. And it felt incredibly rewarding to both be able to provide that technical knowledge and information abroad, and then to use the information and the testing and the work that had been done abroad to help people here in the United States.
That bridge and that two-way exchange of ideas and really learning from each other is an important part of what we all do as we work as diplomats. Mary, anything that you'd like to add, a story?
Sure. In Nicaragua, I was honored when asked to represent USAID and inaugurate a high-profile democracy program in Nicaragua. And I delivered a speech in the town to Nicaraguans and was able to deliver some development messages that generate support among the general public in both the speech and a televised interview. I was inaugurating the completion of the first paved roads in a rural town to improve sanitary and economic conditions in the town, and really interacting with the people and observing the appreciation was the most gratifying part of the ceremony. And I would just say that the fact that several thousand people in Nicaragua will benefit as a result of that program is an outcome that can be valued by all Americans, and I was honored to be a part of it.
Excellent, excellent. Andy, much of your work has focused on youth in your current position.
Yep.
And could you share a story from your current job that we might be able to...
Sure. Well, my role is to really help better connect up young leaders from overseas with our embassies, but more importantly with American counterparts, with one another in particular regions of the world, but also across regions and with American counterparts. And some of the most rewarding work, and I think impactful work that I've seen, has been trying to break down some of the misperceptions that many of us have as people, but in particular as young people. And there have been a couple of initiatives, one in particular called the Active Citizen Summit that we held a little over a year and a half ago. We brought young people from all over the Middle East and North Africa, from Saudi Arabia, from Iran, from Israel, from the Palestinian territories, all together from 17, 18 countries. It was in California for a little bit. They spent 10 days together. They actually had internships and externships with political campaigns on both sides of the political aisle in the United States. And seeing young women and young men from Saudi Arabia and from Iran, from Israel, from the Palestinian territories, knocking on doors, cold calling, campaigning, understanding American democracy at its best, I think, during a campaign cycle, and doing it together, having breakfast together, breaking down misperceptions of one another and seeing people as people, I think was the more fulfilling work. And I think many of us, because of our access, many of us as young people, because of our access to Texas knowledge, engage in a larger world that we live in, I think have a unique opportunity to build and break down those misperceptions that some of our governments may have, but as people and young people, we certainly don't need to embrace, and we can chart our own way forward. So that's just one quick example.
And those kinds of
are
really rare and really rich interaction on a one. I remember being at a Poland with a Bulgarian diplomat for a common language. It turned out that I had and so we were speaking Spanish with each other, and it was very interesting. Andy, could you mute your mic?
Yes.
Okay, got it. Okay, we have a question. Somebody else have a live mic? Nope. Okay. This is a question from our listeners. What classes can one take in high school or college to prepare for a career in diplomacy? Panelists, who would like to lead off with that? Okay, Carla?
So the classes that I talk to my kids about are things related to comparative government, U.S. government, anything which introduces you to different cultures around the world. And what I did in high school was be very involved also in debate. And debate really helped prepare me for the work that I do now, whether it was in terms of public speaking, whether it was thinking about different issues from a critical strategic standpoint, whether it was organizing my thoughts to think about how you design a program or how you advocate for a given position. I thought they were all extremely helpful. And my kids now are doing Model UN and Model Congress, which I think are equally useful in getting them to think about how to engage with the world, to learn about different cultures, and to learn about the work of diplomats.
Okay. Michelle, you look like you have a comment. What classes would you recommend?
Sure. Well, I completely agree with Carla. But also, I also wanted to point out, in order to become a Foreign Service Officer, for example, there's a very unique application process which involves Foreign Service Officer written test and several other elements. But what people can find online are the qualities that we're looking for in our candidates and in our officers. And so if you go on to the careers.state.gov website, you can look something up called the 13 Dimensions of a Foreign Service Officer. And there are 13 qualities that we want all of our diplomats to embody, and they range from composure to planning and organizing skills, oral communication skills, resourcefulness, and these are all skills that students can develop throughout a wide variety of academic backgrounds and experiences. So whether it's in the classroom or volunteering or taking leadership of a program through a student organization or during an internship, students can begin to develop these skills. And they're qualities that, frankly, any employer would love to see in an employee, but particularly for the Foreign Service, the ability to really hone these skills is important.
Excellent. Thank you. We have a question from Maggie on the Google Plus page. And Mary, I'm sorry, you looked like you had something you'd like to add.
Yeah, I just wanted to add that USAID has a different application process, so you can go to usaid.gov/careers and see the variety of positions that we have as diplomats with USAID and the different qualities that we look for as well. And it's just a slightly different application process that I personally was not aware of when I was in college, and was very excited to learn that I could enter into the Foreign Service in a different way instead of passing that extremely difficult State Department test.
Well, Mary, you must have read Maggie's mind, because that was exactly her question, which is, are there alternate routes into the Foreign Service that do not require the Foreign Service Officer exam? So you've answered that. I would also note, Maggie, that there on our website for the State Department, www.state.gov, there are many specialist career tracks where people come in based on their experience, their knowledge, and their education and skills. And so things like information technology career tracks, diplomatic security, human resources, medical fields, the construction engineers. Michelle, is there anything you'd like to add about our specialist career tracks?
Sure. I think there are about 22 different categories. Specialists don't have to take the exam, but they do have to demonstrate that they have the expertise that the job necessitates. So the important thing is to look at the job description for whatever position you're going to be applying for, and note your experience and your skills as they relate to the position description. And the way to find out about these opportunities is to go onto the careers.state.gov website, and you can sign up for something called Keep Me Informed, and you can check off different things that are of interest to you, so whether they're student internships or positions in the Foreign Service Specialist track to civil service. When those opportunities become available or when the applications open, you'll get a direct email alert, so you can act on that right away.
Okay. I'm getting the 5 minute sign here, but Andy, just for two minutes or 1 minute,
talk about the program?
Yeah, sure. I'd be happy to talk about that. I'll also just say that there are a number of routes in players who are involved in the State Department and USAID. You have your Foreign Service officers, which is a very structured process. You take the written exam, you take the oral exam, you pass, you don't pass. Many people, it takes a couple of tries to actually get in through that route. You have civil servants. I'm a civil servant. Many civil servants apply through the USA Jobs portal. Same with USAID has also a number of civil servants through the USA Jobs portal. One of the programs for young recent grads is something called a Presidential Management Fellowship, a program that's across the federal government. You apply during your last year of graduate school, regardless of what you're studying. It's an amazing opportunity to get your foot in the door, to have some rotational opportunities, and then to see if you want to pursue a career at the State Department or USAID or any other federal agency. You also have political appointees who often have some involvement with political campaigns or with the executive branch, and then come in as political appointees for administrations. And then you also have contractors. Contractors who, many of the efforts that we do at a post level are contracted out to third-party partners. And many of them have staff that they hire to go out to a place like the West Bank or to Israel and actually do the work on the ground. So there are a whole slew of opportunities to be a part of the State Department and the Foreign Affairs apparatus. And it's just kind of doing the legwork of applying, casting a wide net, and then keep trying until you get your foot in the door.
Excellent. Excellent. That's a really good point because many of us took the exam, and it took more than one try to make it through the process, those who were trying to go the Foreign Service Officer exam route. Carla, is there anything you'd like to add from your perspective?
I wanted to add two very quick points. The first is there also is a Foreign Commercial Service and a Foreign Agriculture Service. So if you're interested in looking at that trade and commerce or in agriculture specifically, they have their own process for joining. The other is to say a lot of the folks that are working in international affairs are technical experts in a given field. They are environmental experts. They are health sector experts. They are scientists. They are working on democracy and good governance. And so your route in can be as a general interest in international affairs and intercultural experiences, but it also can be a technical one. So you can choose to focus in a specific field and then say how I want to apply that to diplomatic and developmental endeavors worldwide.
Okay. Mary, any final thought? We have about a half a minute.
I'm sorry, I dropped out for a moment. Was it just the same topic as careers?
Oh, Carla was just explaining about all the variety of technical experts that people could pursue to work around, especially on USAID projects.
So, yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, I'm getting the high sign, I think, that we're about to run out of time. So I'd really like to thank our panelists for a very interesting discussion today. I think our time was too short. because there is so much more that we could have discussed and explained about what diplomats do, about all the essential work, whether it's as a foreign service officer, in the civil service, as a contractor, as a specialist. It takes all of us to make American diplomacy work. And I'd like to thank all of you for participating, and particularly, we didn't get to the question of why Mary and Andrew wound up in the Faces of Diplomacy exhibit. That was something that I really wanted to include, but we'll save that perhaps for another future Google Hangout. But I would like to thank you for joining us, thank our listeners for joining us. Our session today has been recorded, and it will be uploaded to the Department of State's YouTube channel. I encourage everybody out there in the Google world to stay tuned. We will have more Google Hangout programs on the way. And thank you, panelists, for joining me today.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Thanks so much. Take care.
Thanks so much. Take care.